So the soul has three characteristics: eternity, knowledge, and bliss. Sat, Chit, Ananda. The soul is eternal. The soul is having consciousness. And the soul is always wanting happiness, ananda, or bliss. But because the soul is encaged within this material body, it is encaged in matter, and it is not able to experience the real happiness within this material world. This material world is not a place for real happiness. And the soul who is identifying himself with the body is again and again getting frustrated in trying to get happiness by utilizing matter and exploiting matter in different ways. So the first C is the conditions. As soon as you enter a particular type of body, you are conditioned. So we'll see that how one is conditioned. The soul belongs to the spiritual world. The soul does not belong to this temporary, miserable material world, which has four real problems: birth, death, old age, and disease. So soul has nothing to do with this material world actually. The home of the soul is the spiritual world. This material world is actually foreign environment for the spirit soul, Atma. So just like, let us try to understand what is called as condition, how the soul is conditioned. So when the soul is in the body of a swan, then it is conditioned to seek shelter in water. When the soul is in the body of a dog, then it is conditioned to seek shelter in land. When the soul enters the body of a bird, it is conditioned to seek shelter in the air, in the sky. So in this way, the soul which is transmigrating in different kinds of bodies is conditioned in different ways, in different kinds of bodies. So in one type of body, the conditions are different. In another type of body, the conditions are different. When the soul is entering the body of a lion, then it is conditioned to eat meat, to kill other animals and eat the flesh. But when the soul is in this human form of body, which is the rarest gift of God, Krishna, for the spirit soul, the special opportunity that the spirit soul gets in this human form of body is that he can revive his original love for God. He can revive, the soul can revive his original relationship which is eternal with respect to God, Krishna. So, this human form of life is very rare and the most precious opportunity. And this human form of body, when the soul is entering this human form of body, at that time also it is conditioned. A human being is conditioned in different ways. Human body is also material body. But this body has a very great speciality. And that is that utilizing this body, we can understand why we are suffering. Why there is birth, old age, disease, and death. Why these four things are there. We don't want these four things. But still these four things are forced upon us. We can inquire in this human form of body. And thereby we can try to understand God. Try to understand our relationship with God. And thereby we can, in the human form of body, we can break this cycle of birth and death and go back to the spiritual world, our eternal home. Free from all conditions. So in human form of body also, these four conditions are put. In any kind of body, these four conditions will be definitely put. Birth, death, old age, and disease. These four problems will be there no matter wherever we go in this material world. In this material world, there are unlimited number of universes which are there. Science also tells that multiple universe theory, and the Vedic texts are also telling that in this material world, there are unlimited number of universes. One universe in which we are living right now, even Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva could not measure the length and breadth of this universe. What to talk about the vastness of this material world in which there are thousands and millions and billions and trillions of universes are there. But wherever we go in this material world, no matter in which universe we go, and within this within every universe, there are 14 planetary systems, 7 above the earthly planetary, 6 planetary systems are above the earthly planetary system, and 7 planetary systems are below the earthly planetary system. Swargalok, Martalok, or Patallok. So these 14 planetary systems, no matter wherever we go, we will have to face these four problems: birth, death, old age, and disease. Only in the spiritual world, these four real problems does not exist. So we have to understand that this great opportunity of human life should not be missed. And utilizing this human form of life, we can go back to the spiritual world, the abode of God, Krishna. So here you can see in this slide, this is the picture of Narad Muni. So, Narad Muni, he does not have a material body like us. His body is completely spiritual. Just by his will, he can go anywhere within this material world and spiritual world at his will. In seconds, he can reach any place. So one time, Ravan was going into in the upper planetary systems, and Narad Muni was also coming to the earthly planetary system, to the earth. So Ravana met Narad Muni, and Ravan told Narad Muni to become his guru. Narad Muni refused. Narad Muni told, "You, Ravana, you disturb women. You always disturb women. You are not respectful towards women. I will not become your guru." Then Ravana took out his sword, and by using that sword, he tried to cut the body of Narad Muni, but he was unable to do it. Spirit soul, spiritual body cannot be cut into pieces. Nainam chindanti shastrani, nainam dahati pavaka, nachainam kledayanti apo, na shoshayati na maruta. This spiritual body cannot be cut into pieces, cannot be burnt by fire, cannot be dried by wind, cannot be moistened by water. It is indestructible. The spirit soul is eternal. There is no destruction of the spirit soul. So Narad Muni is eternally liberated person. He is not encaged within a material body like us. He is actually a transcendental spaceman. Just like a spaceman, a NASA astronaut has to make so much arrangements, mechanical arrangements, to go to the space. But Narad Muni can not only go to the moon planet, but thousands of more ahead, above, he can directly go to the spiritual world at his will. So that is actually the condition of a liberated soul. He is not conditioned. So you said we should understand that these three things, God, man, and this doll. So God is the supreme proprietor. God is the owner of everything. And man, he is a spirit soul encaged within the body. And this doll, it is dead matter. So a dead matter cannot move on its own. A spirit soul is needed. A spirit soul is needed to move the dead matter. So Krishna actually has three energies. Krishna has three energies. Material energy, which is called as matter. The material world is actually the external energy of Krishna. Material world. It is made up of matter. So this doll is actually the external energy of Krishna. So matter, material world is Bohiranga Shakti or external energy. The spiritual world, Adhyatmik Jagat, that is actually internal energy of Krishna. So we have to understand, external energy is material world. internal energy is the spiritual world, and Krishna has the third energy, that is marginal energy. Marginal energy is the spirit soul like us. We can either be in the spiritual world or we can be in the material world, according to our choice. If the soul chooses that he will be in the spiritual world, then he can be in the spiritual world. But if the soul chooses to be in the material world, he will be in the material world. There is always free will that is given to the soul. Krishna, God, never interferes with the free will of the living entity. Krishna gives us a choice. Either you be in the material world or you be in the spiritual world. That is called as marginal energy, tatastha shakti. So external energy is material world, internal energy is spiritual world, and the spirit souls like us, that is the marginal energy of Krishna. It is up to his choice in which world he will be. Right? So these are the three energies of Krishna. Now let us see that what about Lord Krishna's body? Lord Krishna's body is actually completely spiritual. Abhayatma. Krishna doesn't have a material body like us. Krishna's body is completely spiritual. Sat Chit Ananda. When Krishna and Balaram, you see in this picture, Krishna and Balaram, they are doing they are playfully performing their pastimes, their leelas. They are jumping from big mountains. And it's not that their hands and legs are broken. Nothing happens. So just like you saw the spiritual body of Narad Muni, similarly, Krishna is also spiritual body. Krishna Balaram, spiritual body. So Krishna comes to this material world, the Supreme Lord comes to this material world along with his associates, devotees. They are all spiritual. They are not conditioned like us. They are not encaged in a material body like us. When Krishna comes from the spiritual world, he brings his dham with him. He brings his associates, eternal devotees with him. And he performs very wonderful, attractive pastimes in the material world in order to attract the conditioned souls, so that the conditioned soul will be attracted by the pastimes and will have a desire to go back to the spiritual world. So that is why Krishna performs his wonderful pastimes. So Krishna, when he was born in the jail, he was smiling. Have you seen any baby when he is just taken birth? He's smiling. We don't see. He's not smiling. The small baby. Small baby always cries. Cries very much. But Krishna, when he took birth, he was smiling. He's a Supreme Lord. He is not forced to take birth. A living entity, a soul is forced to take birth in a particular type of body according to his karma. He is bound by the law of karma. These living entities, the spirit souls, are bound by the law of karma. But the Supreme Lord, Lord Krishna, is not bound by the law of karma. He is not forced to take birth. He is taking birth out of his own sweet will. So this is the difference between the body of Lord Krishna and the living entities like us. So human form of life provides this opportunity to ask these questions, valuable questions. Why I am conditioned? Why can't I enjoy freely? Why am I suffering? So therefore, we should inquire and try to develop our love for the Supreme Lord. We should inquire who is God. And therefore, these scriptures, the Vedic scriptures, the great scriptures, Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, are given by God so that we can understand. So that we can understand God as He is. Janma karma chame divyam evam yo vetti tatvata yaktya deham punar janma noiti mameti so Arjuna. So Krishna is telling that if one can know His activities, His pastimes, if one can know Him as He is, then he will be eligible to go back to the spiritual world. Janma karma chame divyam evam yo vetti tatvata. If somebody can understand Krishna as He is, then he is eligible to go back to the spiritual world. So therefore, this opportunity is available in this human form of life. So therefore, you should not miss this great opportunity. Otherwise, what will happen? We will be bound in this cycle of birth and death under the clutches of the law of karma. So what is this law of karma? So according to our desires, so law of karma is according to the actions, he gets the reactions. Whatever action he performs, he gets the reactions accordingly. Every action has equal and opposite reaction. So, the soul is also transmigrating from one body to another. But what is the basis? This basis is his desire. If the soul desires something, the Supreme Lord Krishna fulfills that. For example, the soul wants to sleep very much. He will get the body of polar bear in his next life so that he can sleep for 6 months on a trot continuously. So, based on what we deserve and desire, we get a gross body. So two things are there, desire and deserve. Both the things are there. So we may desire something, but we may not deserve that according to the law of karma. We may desire that we will have a big bungalow. We may desire that we'll be the CEO of a company. But according to his past karma, he doesn't have that. He doesn't deserve that. Then he will not get that. One may desire that he will get the body of a heavenly person. But he does not deserve it because he has not done the activities required to get that body. So then you will not get. So law of karma ensures that one gets a particular type of body, not only according to his desires, but also according to his what he is deserving. Both the things are there. But if we desire, here an interesting thing is there, but if we desire that we will serve the Supreme Lord, we will love the Supreme Lord, Krishna, then that desire is actually a spiritual desire. And that will actually liberate us. A spiritual desire liberates us. A material desire will force us to be in this material world. So therefore, this desire is very important. What we desire, this is the free will of the living entity. He can desire whatever he wants. If he wants to serve Krishna, he will go back to the spiritual world. If he wants to serve his senses, then he will remain in the material world. So this is very vital factor for a living entity, that what he is desiring. So here we can see that small children, they are playing with the kitchen utensils. These are all, you know, imitation kitchen utensils. These are not real kitchen utensils. So sometimes what happens, the child demands to the mother that, mother, I want to do cooking. He forces the mother. So the mother gives them these toys, this toy like kitchen utensils. She gives them to play with. So they play for some time. They think that they are cooking. So look, like that, when their play is over, then the mother calls them, your play is over, now come for taking your food. So similarly, when we were in the spiritual world, we were very adamant to God that, no, I want to enjoy separately from you. We were very adamant, just like these children. They were very adamant to their mother that, you know, they want to cook, but they don't know cooking. If the mother gives them the cooking, then it will be disaster. But similarly, so we were very adamant to Krishna that, no, I want to enjoy separately from you. So then Krishna tells that, okay, you want to enjoy separately from me? Okay. Try it out for some time in the material world. Go to the material world. Be in the material world. Try to enjoy separately from me, Krishna tells. Try it for some time. And the living entity comes to the material world. Because of this desire. That is very essential to understand. So then this opportunity. So therefore, when the soul comes to the material world, he tries to enjoy by exploiting matter, by different means. He tries to enjoy that, but ultimately he becomes frustrated, and then he understands that, okay, this material world is not meant for happiness. When Krishna comes through the medium of his devotees, Krishna intervenes in the life of a person through the medium of his devotees. Krishna sends his devotees in his life. And Krishna guides every living entity, every soul from inside as Paramatma. And thereby, Krishna helps to get back that spirit soul back to the spiritual world. Because every spirit soul is part and parcel of Krishna, is the son of God. And Krishna wants all his children back. The mother calls back these children after their play is over. Now come back, take your lunch. So Krishna
call is calling us back,
that you have tried enough in different ways. Now you understand that this is material world. This is imitation. The happiness out here is imitation happiness. The real happiness is not there. Just like these children, they were using the imitation kitchen utensils. They are not the real kitchen utensils. They cannot cook the real chapatis. They cannot cook the real rice. So Krishna tells that you come back.
Mam upetya punar janma dukhalayam ashashvatam napnuvanti mahatman shamsiddhim paramam gata.
So can anyone read it? Diptesh, can you read it? The translation? Hare Krishna. Am I audible, Diptesh? Ashish? Am I audible? Can you read the translation of this shloka? Hare Krishna. Oh, acha. I didn't unmute. Oh, acha. Okay. Oh, that's the problem happening. I muted. Okay. Ashish. Okay, I'm asking you to unmute. Yes, Ashish, you can read.
Yeah. After attaining me, the great souls who are yogas in devotion never return to the temporary world, which is full of miseries, because they have attained the highest perfection.
Yes. So Krishna is telling that the great souls, napnuvanti mahatmana, the great souls, the mahatma devotees of the Lord, the great souls who are yogis in devotion. Yogis in devotion means what? They are connected with Krishna, connected with the Supreme Lord. Yoga. Yoga means connection. Generally, people in this world, what do they understand by yoga? They understand some practices by which they can keep their health nice. This is not the actual definition of yoga. Yoga means connecting with the Supreme, the Supreme Person. The great souls who are yogis in devotion, like Arjuna, is a yogi in devotion. He is working for the pleasure of Krishna. Never return to this temporary world, which is full of miseries, because they have attained the highest perfection. Naptubanti mahatmana samsiddhim paramam gata. Once one attains the spiritual world, there is no question of returning back to this temporary material world. So Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is giving this assurance. Natad bhasayate suryo nasashanko na pavaka yat gatva na nibartante tad dham paramam mama. That eternal abode, eternal dham, eternal spiritual world, if anyone goes there, he never has to return back to this temporary miserable material world. And that is possible by devotional service. And what is devotional service? By engaging in the service of Krishna. By chanting the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, we are engaging in the service of Krishna. This Hare Krishna Mahamantra is actually, the soul is expressing his desire to the Supreme Lord Krishna and his energy. By chanting the Hare Krishna Mantra, we are pleading to the Lord that, O Krishna, O energy of Krishna, please engage me in your service. That is the meaning of Hare Krishna Mahamantra. We are pleading to engage in Krishna's service. We are pleading to engage. We are pleading to love Krishna and serve Krishna. Service and love, these are inseparable actually. These cannot be separated from each other. Love means service. So that is devotional service. Acting in that way of loving and serving the Supreme Lord Krishna. And when we engage in devotional service, beginning with chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, then we gradually understand the Supreme Lord Shri Krishna and we are gradually liberated from the clutches of this material world. Everyone is wanting liberation. No one is wanting to be, you know, conditioned. No one wants suffering. But what is the real way of liberation? Only by engaging ourselves in the transcendental service of Krishna. And this begins with chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. This Hare Krishna Maha Mantra is actually transcendental. That means it is not material. It is not a material vibration. Just like Coca-Cola. This Coca-Cola is actually a material sound vibration. How many times one can chant Coca-Cola? One time, two times, 1,000 times, 5,000 times. After that, you will see a Coca-Cola bottle and you will throw away that Coca-Cola bottle. You will be disgusted with Coca-Cola. This happens, you know. So, but this Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, this is not a material sound vibration. It is spiritual sound vibration. The more we chant, the more we can get the bliss that we will want to chant even more. So nobody has to tell, nobody has to give the certificate that what we are experiencing by chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. If we ourselves apply this Hare Krishna Maha Mantra in our life more and more, we will ourselves understand. Nobody else will have to make us understand. So therefore, we have to chant these holy names of Krishna with utmost, with sincerity and regularity every day, without fail. So people in the material world, they neglect God's laws. They tell that I don't care. People tell that I don't care the laws of God. The laws of God are mentioned so nicely in the Bhagavad Gita. But people don't care for these laws. But if we do not care for these laws, then we will only suffer. Nobody else will suffer. So the laws are given for the benefit of the citizens. Similarly, in this material world, the laws are given so that the conditioned souls will not be entangled in this material world and will be by following these laws, one will be liberated from the clutches of the material energy. That is why Krishna gave the laws, what to do and what not to. In the Bhagavad Gita, in the different scriptures, Vedic scriptures. So therefore, we should not disregard these laws. We should take them very seriously. Then we'll be able to get out of the clutches of this material energy. But if we say that we don't care, so then right now we may be enjoying by telling I don't care. But when there will be problem, then we will only be the sufferer. So just like this world civilization, the materialistic civilization of this world, it was advancing materially very much. It was breaking the laws of God. There are four pillars of sinful activities, four pillars of sin. These four pillars of sin are meat eating, gambling, intoxication, and illicit sex. These are the four pillars of sin. So, just like pillar, a building stands on the columns, the pillars. So, the sinful life of a living entity, of a human being, stands on these four pillars. Meat eating is causing violence to the living entities. It is an act of violence. We cannot understand God by indulging in meat eating, by becoming violent to God's children, other children. They are also children. We are also children. We cannot take their lives just for the taste of the tongue. So meat eating, this is a pillar of sin. Then gambling. What is gambling? Jua, Las Vegas, America, the biggest gambling place in this world. So that gambling, it is a pillar of sin. Intoxication, drinking cigarettes, wine, drugs, marijuana, ganja, all these intoxications. This destroys the body. This is a pillar of sin. And illicit sex, indulging in sexual life before marriage, disregarding the regulation of married life. If somebody is indulging in sex life, that is illicit sex, that is against the Vedic principles. And that creates havoc in the life of the youngsters. And especially in this age, in this degraded age of Kali Yuga, one should be very careful about the different pornographic sites which are there in the internet, which is ruining the life of thousands and thousands of engineering students in India and all over the world. This is also an act of illicit sex. One should not see illicit sex going on in the internet and degrade one's consciousness and lose one's semen. Semen is actually very, very vital substance of the body. The most vital substance of this body is semen. It is a dhatu. It should never be lost. By retaining semen, one's memory power increases, one's concentration increases, one's determination increases, one's power to discriminate increases, vichar shakti increases. So therefore, one should be very careful about these four pillars of sin. One should not indulge in any of these four activities: meat eating, gambling, intoxication, and illicit sex. These four things. These are the four pillars of sinful life. So Krishna is giving us through Guru Parampara, Krishna is giving us what not to do and what to do. So Srila Prabhupada recommended this chanting of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, and he gave the four regulative principles. No meat eating, no gambling, no illicit sex, no intoxication. So in America, when Prabhupada went to America, The founder Acharya of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada, he went to America. One of his disciples told him that Prabhupada, you can reduce one regulative principle. Then you will have more followers actually. So Prabhupada told that, no, I have not come here to simply increase followers. I have come here to give the message of Krishna as it is, without any compromise. So there are many, religious institutions are there. They tell that, oh, you take diksha, you go on eating meat, you go on drinking wine, you go on doing illicit sex, and you go on doing gambling, you go on, by drinking cigarette, bidi, you just take initiation, diksha, and you will be successful. No, this is actually cheating. One should not take shelter of a cheating religion. Pure religion, the pure spiritual message is actually understandable only in Guru Parampara, bona fide Guru Parampara. And Srila Prabhupada is in the line of bona fide Guru Parampara coming from Brahmaji. There are four bona fide Guru Paramparas: Brahma Sampradaya, Sri Sampradaya, Kumar Sampradaya, and Rudra Sampradaya. These are the four bona fide Guru Parampara systems. And ISKCON is in Brahma Sampradaya. The first Guru is Brahmaji. In that line of disciplic succession, Guru Parampara system, ISKCON is coming. So, Srila Prabhupada gave the actual essence of the scriptures. He gave the Bhagavad Gita as it is, so that we can understand what is the message of Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita as it is, without any compromise. Srila Prabhupada struggled in India for 40 years. In 1922, Srila Prabhupada's spiritual master, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, gave him the instruction that preach the message of Lord Chaitanya in the Western countries. Srila Prabhupada tried to preach in India. He tried to make Indians realize the science of Krishna for 40 years, from 1922. To 1962, 44 years, he tried in India to spread the message of Krishna consciousness in India to the Indians, but he failed for 44 years. Hardly one person he could make understand in India. After failing for 44 years, he went to America, where people don't know anything about Krishna. They don't know about Krishna at all, and they are leading very sinful life. They're always, taking wine. They're always, drinking, cigarettes. They're leading sinful life. They're always eating meat. So to that land of America he went after failing for 44 years in India. If somebody fails in class 10 for 44 years, will he ever give the exam again? You will not give the exam. 44 times failure in class 10. If somebody fails for 2-3 times, he will not again give the exam. He will not sit for the exam in the fifth time. So imagine somebody failing in class 12 for 44 times. It's unimaginable actually. So Srila Prabhupada failed in India to preach this message of Krishna for 44 years. 44 years he struggled in India. He was failure, but he never gave up hope. He never gave up hope. His spiritual master's instruction was deep in his heart. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur told him to go and preach in the Western countries in the English language. In 1966, he went in Jaladuta cargo ship to the Western country, America. And after going to America, he made the hippies into first devotees. Hippie logo ko pehle bhakt banaya. Hippies logo ko, he made the hippies into happies. They were the first persons to become devotees. And these hippies were always high on LSD. So Srila Prabhupada told that you all want to always remain high, so take this Hare Krishna Mahamantra. So Srila Prabhupada gave the ultimate solution to all the problems. So Srila Prabhupada gave this chanting of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. This is mentioned in the scriptures. He didn't manufacture anything. A real spiritual master, a real guru will not manufacture anything. He will simply repeat what the scriptures tell. And that is why, all over the world today, they are taking advantage of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. That how, even the Pakistanis, I gave a photo in the WhatsApp group today, that the Pakistanis, ISKCON Pakistan Karachi, and that photo I gave in the WhatsApp group, and the boys are sitting in one, the Muslim boys are sitting in one side, the girls in another side, chanting Hare Krishna. They are trying to understand Bhagavad Gita in such a disciplined way, unimaginable. This is Karachi, Pakistan. China, in China, Beijing. The devotees are trying, they are chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra. They cannot pronounce Hare. They pronounce Hale. The R they pronounce as L. But they are chanting the Hare Krishna Mantra. Do you think Krishna will not accept that? Definitely Krishna will accept that. Because Krishna is seeing the mood, the bhav. So therefore, if the more we sincerely accept the science of Krishna consciousness, the more easily we will be liberated from the clutches of the material energy, Maya. But if we are increasing our material desires more and more, then we will be more and more bound in this material world. One desire after another desire after another desire, material desire. Asha pas shato shato klesho day abirato. The more we have material desires, I have to do this, I have to do that. Okay, you have your ambitions. We are not telling that you don't have ambition. If you have ambition to become a CEO of a company, okay, very good. Utilize that ambition, utilize that talent in Krishna service. Don't become like another materially successful person. Even greatest of the materially successful persons had greatest, horrible deaths at the end of their lives. Michael Jackson wanted to live for 150 years. He had 6 doctors every time watching him, measuring his heartbeat. Whenever he used to take lunch, his lunch plate used to go for laboratory examination. Then he used to take lunch. But forget about 150, he died in the 50s only. Could not even live for 100 years. But if we utilize our talents in Krishna's service, the same, another American, Michael Jackson was an American. See the example of another American, Alfred Ford. They both are Americans. Michael Jackson also American, Alfred Ford is also American. Alfred Ford is chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra for the past 46 years. And he is the owner of Ford Motor Company, the great grandson of Henry Ford. So he's a successful businessman. But he is utilizing his talents, he is utilizing his everything in Krishna's service. That is needed. We are not telling that become desireless. We cannot be desireless. We have to have spiritual desires. Material desires will bind us in this material world. Spiritual desires will liberate us from this material world. All the resources we can utilize in Krishna's service. But if we don't use, if we utilize the resources that we have got, if we utilize the talents that we have got in our own sense gratification, then it will be, we will be more and more bound in this material world. Suffering from all directions will come. But if we are spiritualizing our desires, then even if sufferings are there, still we will be happy. The external sufferings will not affect us. So, in the Shastras talk about six kinds of whip. Chabuk, which we call in Bengali. Six kinds of whips that Maya Devi is always giving us in this material world. At every moment, every day, hunger, thirst, old age, death, illusion, lamentation. Hunger, every day we feel hungry. Thirst, every day we feel thirsty. Old age, every day we are going towards old age. Lamentation. Lamentation happens every day. One laments, oh, if I could have had more money. Oh, I could have had this. I could have had that. Illusion. Thinking that this is real happiness. Acquiring more and more is real happiness. This is illusion. And death. Every day we are moving closer to death. So these six whips, the six, you know, the chabuk, the six whips, Maya Devi is always beating us through these six whips. Who is Maya Devi? Maya Devi is Durga Devi, Devi Durga. So just like Krishna, Krishna is the supreme owner of all the material world and spiritual world, both the worlds. But this material world, Krishna is not directly controlling. Krishna is controlling through Maya Devi, Durga Devi. Just like the Prime Minister does not directly control the jail. The Prime Minister controls the jail through the jailer. So this material world is also a jail. This is such a wonderful jail that nobody wants to go out of this jail. But the jailer of this jail is Durga Devi, Maya Devi. The jailer, just like the jailer gives punishment to the jail inmates, similarly, the Durga Devi, Maya Devi is giving these six kinds of whips to the conditioned living entities. So, therefore, the conditions of the subtle body, the mind is always in fear, envy, worry, stress, grief, greed, no confidence, all these things, tension, and the mind is always engaged in these things, the conditions of this mind. But if the mind is filled with Krishna consciousness, if we engage to make the mind listen to the Hare Krishna Mahamantra in the morning time by the chanting of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, and then we study the literatures like Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, we come to these kinds of online meetings every week. We are understanding Krishna, we are studying about Krishna, we are understanding about the material world, we are understanding about the spiritual world, we are understanding about our relationship with Krishna. Then the mind will be engaged in a positive way and it will be happily situated. The Vedic literature tells, asato ma sadgamaya tamaso ma jyotirgamaya mrityor ma amritam gamaya asato ma sadgamaya. This material body is temporary. Let us go back to the spiritual world and get a spiritual body. Asato ma sadgamaya. from temporary world to eternal world. Tamaso ma jyotirgamaya. That means this, in this material world, everyone is in ignorance. He has forgotten his relationship with Krishna, God. That is tamaso, avidya. Avidya jatona ar nahi shahe janamo morono mala. So this avidya is ignorance. Ignorance of one's relationship with Krishna, God. And that is giving us suffering. That is making us entangled in the cycle of birth and death. Birth, death, this cycle is going on. So tamaso ma jyotirgamaya. From this cycle of birth and death to eternal life in the spiritual world. Mrityurma amritam gamaya. From this world of death to the world of deathlessness and fearlessness. So that is the instruction of the Vedic literatures. So second C is conditions, conditionings. So till now we have saw about the conditions. So now we'll see about the conditionings. So conditionings basically refers to our habits. The mind is like a book. Change habits by changing the scripts written in the mind. So according to what we engage our mind, we develop the habits. So Krishna tells a very beautiful verse, the Bhagavad Gita. Yehi sangsparsha ja bhoga dukhayo nayevate adyanta vanta kanteya nateshu ramate buddha. Arindam, can you read? What is the translation?
An intelligent person does not take part in the source of misery, which are due to contract with material sense. O son of Kunti, such pleasure have a beginning and an end. And so the wiser man does not delight in them.
So wise man does not delight in the source of misery. Yehi sangsparsa jabhoga dukha yonaya evate. When the sense is coming in contact with the sense objects, then what happens? Then misery takes birth. So what is sense object? So what is sense? We have five senses. Eyes, ears, nose, tongue. Five senses are there. These are the knowledge acquiring senses. So sense comes in contact with sense object. The tongue is wanting to eat voraciously tasty food. Always. In that endeavor, the tongue searches out and indulges in meat eating. And then there is suffering later. Similarly, the eyes are always, you know, running towards beautiful women. So beautiful women are sense objects for the eyes. And when the eyes are wandering here and there, eyes are wandering in this direction, the latter there is the misery takes birth. The ears are always wanting to hear Bollywood musics, and the Bollywood music is actually the sense object for the ears. So rather than hearing Bollywood music, one should hear the kirtan. Beautiful kirtans are there in the YouTube. Beautiful kirtans one can hear. The Krishna conscious things in YouTube. But if one indulges in towards wrong things, material things, then it will be, the sense will get in contact with the sense objects. So, therefore, the birthplace of dukkha, the birthplace of misery is where? When the sense comes in contact with the sense objects. That is the birthplace of misery. So a wise person does not delight in them. That is important to understand here. The Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is telling. Another very beautiful verse Krishna is telling.
Vishaya vinivartante nirāharasya dehina raso varyam raso aham apsu param drishtva nivartate.
We'll read. Arnav, can you read? Arnav? I've asked him to unmute.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Please read the translation.
Though the embodied soul may be restricted from sense enjoyment, the taste of sense object remains, but casing such engagements by experiencing a higher taste, he is fixed in consciousness.
Yes. Seizing. So, raso varjam, raso api asya, param drishtva nivartate. So, for example, let us consider that there is a plate of khichdi in front of us. And another plate is there which has fried rice. Then there is chili paneer. There is nice pakora. There is nice payasam. So this plate is there. Another plate is there, khichdi. So which plate will one go toward? The other plate which has fried rice, chili paneer, pakora, payash, that plate, isn't it? One will not look towards the khichdi plate. So somebody asked, yeah, Sobhik asked, embodied soul. Embodied soul means like us. The soul is encased in a body. Embodied. The soul is encased within a body. I am encased in human body. Some soul is encased in a snake body. Embodied. Conditioned soul. Right? So what was telling that, yes, that person will be looking towards that other plate. He will not look towards the khichdi plate. So therefore, materialistic persons, they don't know how to get the real happiness. They don't know the spiritual process of gaining happiness. They don't know these Vedic scriptures, Bhagavad Gita knowledge. Therefore, they try to get happiness in lower things. But if one gets spiritual happiness, he will not look towards material happiness anymore. By experiencing higher taste, he is fixed in consciousness. Higher taste. Somebody who has got a higher taste, he will not look towards the lower taste. Somebody who has got spiritual taste, he will not look towards the lower taste of this material world. Therefore, you have to develop this higher taste. The higher taste you can develop by engaging the senses in Krishna conscious activities. By utilizing the tongue, we can chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. By utilizing the ears, we can hear about Krishna. We can hear about the beautiful kirtans of Krishna. That is higher taste. One who has got that taste for kirtan, he will not move towards the taste of Bollywood songs. Because he has got a higher taste. Similarly, if we experience Krishna Prasad, so right now you are not able to experience Krishna Prasad because you are in home right now. Physically, we are not able to meet. So therefore, if you can imagine in your mind, when you take Krishna Prasad, pure vegetarian Krishna Prasad, then you will not anymore look towards You will not look towards the other other material food anymore. You will be satisfied by taking Krishna prasad. So, by developing higher taste, he can give up lower taste. And the third C is cutthroat competition. In this material world, there is a law, jiva jivasya jivanam. One living entity is the food for another living entity. For the kite, the food is the snake. For the lion, the food is the wild cat. For the wild cat, the food is the mouse. And the rabbit, and for wild cat, the food is the rabbit. And for the rabbit, the food is the mouse. So in that way, there is this cycle in this material world. Jeev, jivasya, jivanam. There is competition. Always competition is there. But in the spiritual world, also there are animals, but they are not competing with each other. They are not killing each other and eating. They are happy in the spiritual world. Everyone is taking shelter of the Supreme Lord, trying to serve the Supreme Lord Krishna. Everyone is trying to serve Krishna. Krishna is trying to serve everyone. There is a competition in that way in the spiritual world. There is a competition of service. There is no competition of exploitation. In the material world, there is competition of exploitation. But in the spiritual world, there is competition of service. The devotees are wanting to serve Krishna and Krishna is trying to serve his devotees. So this competition is going on in the spiritual world. But in the material world, there is competition of exploitation. So due to the COVID-19, you see so many people are becoming jobless. And for getting a job, one tries to exploit others and get the job by any means, by hook or crook, trying to exploit another person. So this is the tendency in the material world. Material world, exploitation is there. Spiritual world, there is always service. In the material world, we hear the slogan, work harder and you'll earn more money. Buy more things and keep going like this. And that will be the real happiness. Working like a donkey all day around. A donkey is having a carrot in front of him. Just see. The washerman gives this carrot. The donkey is thinking, if I work hard, if I run, then I'll get the carrot. But the carrot he never gets. So, this carrot represents the happiness in this material world. Now we are trying to get happiness in this material world, but real happiness is not possible to get in the material world. Real happiness is there in the spiritual world, but we feel by working, simply working harder, simply earning more money, simply buying more things, we can get happiness. This is actually illusion. This is not reality. And by enjoying sex, we'll get happiness. This is illusion. So yes, one has to work. Okay, it's not that I am telling not do job. I am not telling that. But to understand the essence of this material world, people are thinking that just by doing job, just by working hard and earning more money, I'll get happiness. But this is wrong philosophy of life. One can utilize his job, one can utilize his talents, one can utilize his everything in the service of Krishna. And that is the way of getting happiness. We cannot be aloof from everything. We have to be in this material world till the time we are in this body. So you have to utilize the principle. You have to utilize the things that we have in the service of Krishna. But you should see that we are managing our time in such a way that we can practice spiritual life. That is very essential. We have to understand and analyze our life. You have to get that time somehow or the other to practice spiritual life. And the morning time is the best time. somehow or the other, if we have to chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra in the morning time, getting up early in the morning, early to bed, early to rise, makes the man healthy, wealthy and wise. Is the Vedic philosophy. If we are not able to utilize the morning time, then we will not be able to practice spiritual life nicely. So this chanting is very effective in the morning time. The atmosphere is very calm in the morning time. And there is lack of distractions in the morning time. There are very less distractions. The mind is peaceful. So therefore, let us try to chant this Hare Krishna Maha Mantra in the morning time. So then, there's competition among countries also. America is manufacturing the best of the fighter aircrafts. Russia is manufacturing the best of the missiles. China is manufacturing the best of the submarines. So like that, there is competition in this material world. But ultimately, what is happening? This is leading to war, and this is suffering actually. So this is not the real, this competitive mentality, this is not the culture of the spiritual world. The spiritual world, the culture is service, completely opposite. So therefore, we should try to go back to the spiritual world. Alexander, when he died, what he told, Alexander told his followers that when he is dying, what instruction he gave. Ashish, can you read? What instruction Alexander gave to his followers after his death? Yes. Please read. Go ahead and read. Okay. Arindam, can you read? I have to unmute. Man. Ask to unmute. Yeah.
Vary my body and don't bile any monument and keep my hands out so that people know the one who owned the world had nothing in the hand when he died.
Alexander told this to make the people realize Alexander was practically the king of the whole world. But when he died, he could not take anything with him. So therefore, the only thing, the real substance that you can get is spiritual. The real bank account is not material bank account. The real bank account is spiritual bank account. This will be permanent. The more we are chanting, we are increasing our spiritual bank account. Our material bank account, after death, it will go to another person's name. But the spiritual bank account, the more we chant, the entire life, whatever we chant, that will remain with us permanently. That credit will remain with us. And if we are completely able to make this human form of life successful, then we will go back to the spiritual world. So, we have to invest in the proper direction. This material world is like a forest fire. Sangsara dava nalalidha loka tranaya karunya gana gana tvam praptasya kalyana gunarnavashya bande guru shri charanarabindam. The forest fire, you see, very dangerous. The material world is like a forest fire. How can the forest fire be extinguished? If there is a shower of water from the helicopter above, then the forest fire can be extinguished. Similarly, our life in this material world is like a forest fire. There is so much suffering. Only when we get the mercy of a devotee, the Guru Parampara, then we can mitigate the suffering of this material world. We are trying to enjoy in the material world, but there is no enjoyment. We don't know where to enjoy forever. A mirage in the desert, one feels that there is water in the mirage, but actually there is no water. But one feels that there is water. This is illusion. In the spiritual world, there is ever increasing bliss. Anandamayo abhyasat. The relations with the Supreme Lord are permanent, and one can enjoy more and more and more in relation to the Supreme Lord Krishna. In different ways, one can become his lover, one can become his friend, one can become his servant in the spiritual world. So there is great opportunity, and that is eternal opportunity. Everlasting and immortal pastimes. Lover of the Lord, parental love, one can become friend of the Lord. So much enjoyment in the spiritual world. In this picture, you see that the cat is taking the kitten in his mouth. So this kitten, it is not in suffering. But you see this rat in the mouth of the cat. This rat is suffering very much. So this is the difference between the death of a materialistic person and the death of a Krishna conscious person, devotee of Krishna. A devotee of Krishna, the death is like this. The kitten in the mouth of the cat. And for a non-devotee, materialistic person, it is like the situation is like rat in the mouth of the cat. The rat dies a horrible death. So devotee of the Lord also dies. But after death, he is transported to the spiritual world. This is his final life. But a non-devotee, he is repeating his cycle of birth and death again and again in different types of bodies. So that is the thing. So I am ending here today's discussion. So if you have any questions, you can ask.